Penguin Audio presents The Chaperone by Laura Moriarty, read by Elizabeth McGovern. Part 1. When a lovely woman stoops to folly, she can always find someone to stoop with her, but not always someone to lift her up again to the level where she belongs. Mr. Grundy for Atlantic Monthly, 1920. It excited him, too, that many men had already loved Daisy. It increased her value in his eyes. F. Scott Fitzgerald, The Great Gatsby, 1925. There is no Garbo. There is no Dietrich. There is only Louise Brooks. Henri Langlois, 1955. Chapter 1. The first time Cora heard the name Louise Brooks, she was parked outside the Wichita Library in a Model T Ford, waiting for the rain to stop. If Cora had been alone, unencumbered, she might have made a dash across the lawn and up the library stone steps, but she and her friend Viola Hammond had spent the morning going door to door in their neighborhood, collecting books for the new children's room, and the considerable fruits of their efforts were safe and dry in four crates in the back seat. The storm, they decided, would be a short one, and they couldn't risk the books getting wet. And really, Cora thought, staring out into the rain, it wasn't as if she had anything else to do. Her boys were already gone for the summer, both of them working on a farm outside Winfield. In the fall, they would leave for college. Cora was still getting used to the quiet and also the freedom of this new era of her life. Now, long after Della left for the day, the house stayed clean, with no muddy footprints on the floor and no records scattered around the phonograph. There were no squabbles over the car to mediate, no tennis matches at the club to cheer on, and no assigned essays to proofread and commend. The pantry and icebox actually stayed stocked with food without daily trips to the store. Today, with Alan at work, she had no reason to rush home at all. "I'm glad we took your car and not ours," Viola said, adjusting her hat, which was pretty, a puffed turban with an ostrich feather curling down from the crown. "People say closed cars are a luxury, but not on a day like this." Cora gave her what she hoped was a modest smile. Not only was the car covered, it had come with an electric starter. "Cranking cars, no business for a lady," was how the ad went, though Alan had admitted he didn't miss cranking either. Viola turned, eyeing the books in the back seat. "People were generous," she allowed. Viola was a decade older than Cora, her hair already gray at the temples, and she spoke with the authority of her added years. "Mostly, you notice Myra Brooks didn't even open her door." Cora hadn't noticed. She'd been working the other side of the street. Maybe she wasn't home. "I heard the piano." Viola's eyes slid toward Cora. "She didn't bother to stop playing when I knocked. I have to say she's very good." Lightning shot across the western sky, and though both women flinched, Cora, without thinking, smiled. She'd always loved these late spring storms. They came on so fast, rolling in from the prairie on expanding columns of clouds, a welcome release from the day's building heat. An hour before, when Cora and Viola were canvassing, the sun was hot in a blue sky. Now rain fell fast enough to slice green leaves from the big oak outside the library. The lilacs trembled and tossed. "Don't you think she's a tiresome snob?" Cora hesitated. She didn't like to gossip, but she could hardly count Myra Brooks as a friend. And they'd been to how many suffrage meetings together? Had marched together in the street? Yet if she passed Myra today on Douglas Avenue, Cora wouldn't get so much as a hello. Still, she never got the feeling that it was snobbery as much as Myra simply not registering her existence, and there was a chance it was nothing personal. Myra Brooks didn't seem to look at anyone, Cora had noticed, not unless she was the one speaking, watching for the impression she made. And yet, of course, everyone looked at her. She was, perhaps, the most beautiful woman Cora had ever seen in person. She had pale skin, flawless, and large dark eyes, and then all that thick, dark hair. She was certainly a talented speaker. Her voice was never shrill, and her enunciations were clear. But everyone knew it was Myra's looks that had made her a particularly good spokeswoman for the movement, a nice antidote to the newspaper's idea of what a suffragist looked like. And you could tell she was intelligent, cultured. She was supposed to know everything about music, the works of all the famous composers. She certainly knew how to charm. Once, when she was at the podium, she'd looked down at Cora, right into her eyes, and smiled as if they were friends.
"I don't really know her," Cora said.
She looked back out through the blurred windshield at people ducking out from a streetcar, running for cover. Alan had taken a streetcar to work so she could have the Ford.
"Then I'll inform you, Myra Brooks is a tiresome snob."
Viola turned to Cora with a little smile, the ostrich plume grazing her chin.
"I'll give you the latest example. She just sent a note to the secretary of our club. Apparently, Madame Brooks is looking for someone to accompany one of her daughters to New York this summer. The older one, Louise, got into some prestigious dance school there, but she's only 15. Myra actually wants one of us to go with her. For over a month."
Viola seemed pleasantly outraged, her cheeks rosy, her eyes bright.
"I mean, really, I don't know what she's thinking, that we're the help? That one of us will be her Irish nanny?"
She frowned and shook her head.
"Most of us have progressive husbands, but I can't imagine any one of them would spare a wife for over a month so she could go to New York City of all places. Myra herself is too busy to go. She has to lie around the house and play the piano."
Cora pursed her lips. New York. She felt the old ache right away.
"Well, I suppose she has other children to look after." "Oh, she does, but that's not it. She doesn't take care of them. They're motherless, those children. Poor Louise goes to Sunday school by herself. The instructor is Edward Vincent, and he picks her up and takes her home every Sunday. I heard that right from his wife. Myra and Leonard are alleged Presbyterians, but you never see them at church, do you? They're too sophisticated, you see. They don't make the other children go either."
"That speaks well of the daughter, that she makes the effort to go on her own." Cora cocked her head. "I wonder if I've ever seen her."
"Louise, oh, you would remember. She didn't look like anyone else. Her hair's black like Myra's, but perfectly straight like an Oriental's, and she wears it in a Buster Brown."
Viola gestured just below her ears.
"She didn't bob it. She had it cut like that when they moved here years ago. It's too short and severe, a horrible look in my opinion, not feminine at all. But even so, I have to say she's a very pretty girl. Prettier than her mother."
She smiled, leaning back in her seat.
"There's some justice in that, I think."
Cora tried to picture this black-haired girl, more beautiful than her beautiful mother. Her gloved hand moved to the back of her own hair, which was dark, but not remarkably so. It certainly wasn't perfectly straight, though it looked presentable, she hoped, pinned up under her straw hat. Cora had been told she had a kind, pleasant face, and that she was lucky to have good teeth. But that had never added up to striking beauty. And now she was 36.
"My own girls are threatening to cut their hair," Viola said with a sigh. "Foolish. This bobbin business is just a craze. When it's over, Everyone who followed the lemons over the cliff will need years to grow their hair out. A lot of people won't hire girls with bobbed hair. I try to warn them, but they won't listen. They just laugh at me. And they have their own language, their own secret code for them and their friends. Do you know what Ethel called me the other day? She called me a werp. That's not a real word, but when I tell them that, they laugh.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.